All right, well, let's go ahead and get started here. So welcome, everyone, to our virtual media event here. So my name is Danny Katz. I am the chair of the Denver Streets Partnership and the director of COPIRG, the Colorado Public Interest Research Group. If you're not familiar, the Denver Streets Partnership is a coalition of organizations advocating for people-friendly streets. We're advocating for anything from changing street designs to reducing speed limits to infrastructure improvements like bike lanes and safer crossings and signal timings, a whole array of things so that we can tackle the growing challenge that we have seen in terms of unsafe streets. 2019 was one of our most dangerous years yet with 70 fatalities. We find that unacceptable. And so right now we are releasing our annual report card on the city of Denver's implementation of their own Vision Zero plan. If you're not familiar, Vision Zero is the concept that we should have zero deaths and fatalities on our streets. The information that we're going over can be found on our website at denverstreetspartnership.org. We have a link to the exact page in the chat box. If you can't see that, it's denverstreetspartnership.org, and you can find the pull-down menu for Vision Zero, and the information will be there. We'll take questions at the end, and some of you have already started putting those questions in the chat box, which is great, so we'll definitely cover that. For now, let me turn it over to Jill Lucantori, who is the director of the Denver Streets Partnership and the author of our report card.
Thank you, Danny. Good morning, everybody. I am Jill Lucantori, the executive director of the Denver Streets Partnership. I'm going to start sharing my screen so that we can look at the report card together. This is our second annual Vision Zero Action Plan Progress Report Card, and we are measuring the city's project progress towards the goals that the city identified in the action plan that it developed and adopted in 2017. Specifically, we are focusing on 8 goals related to building safe street infrastructure. We believe that a foundational problem is that our streets are unsafe by design. And without making these critical infrastructure improvements, we will never get to the goal of zero traffic fatalities. And so the plan does include specific numeric goals for building different types of infrastructure on an annual basis. We graded them in each of these three areas, or each of these areas, and we looked at not only did they meet their numeric goal in terms of, for example, the miles of bike lanes built, but we also looked at the location of where they implemented these changes. And in particular, were these implemented on the high injury network, which is the 5% of the streets where 50% of the traffic fatalities occur, as well as are they focused in what the city has referred to as communities of concern, which are areas that tend to be lower income households, households without cars, and where we see a preponderance of the traffic crashes and fatalities happening. And then we also graded the quality of the improvements. Did the changes that the city made, did they actually achieve the intended outcome of improving safety for all users, and particularly the more vulnerable users on our roads, people walking and biking? So I'll quickly touch on these different categories that we graded in. We can certainly answer more detailed questions at the end during the Q&A. But starting with some of the areas where the city fell short, Once again, in sidewalks, the city fell well short of their annual goal of building 14 miles of new sidewalks, only completing 5 in 2019, and virtually none of those sidewalks were in the high injury network. And so we gave them an F in that category. For bike lanes, this is an area where the city had gotten an A on their progress in 2018, but they fell behind in 2019. Building a little bit more than half of their stated goal of 20 miles of bike lanes. And so we gave them a C in that area. On redesigning intersections and installing better pedestrian crossings, the city did a great job numerically, far exceeding their target for the number of these improvements. But again, the vast majority of these were not on the high injury network. And so we downgraded them slightly in their overall grade in those two categories. Another area where the city fell short was in using smart city technologies to improve traffic safety at intersections. The city did install some data collection devices at 12 different intersections across the city, but these are just collecting data. They're not doing anything at the moment to actually improve safety at those intersections. And so we graded them down on in that category. Some areas where the city did really well were some operational improvements at intersections. So adding things like leading pedestrian intervals where people get the walk signal first before cars get the green light, giving them an opportunity to get out and safely visible in the intersection. Also, the city enhanced street lighting throughout the city of Denver on too many corridors to count. And so those were two areas where they really did a great job. And then also implementing traffic calming on corridors. So these are adding physical changes like bulb outs at the intersections, mini traffic circles, diverters, as well as repurposing street space for dedicated bus lanes, which really not only improves the street for people walking, biking, and taking transit, but reinforces safer, slower speeds on those streets. This is another area where the city did really well in 2019. And we've seen continued momentum on this in 2020 with additional traffic calming installed in early 2020, starting right off in January. And so later in our press conference, we're going to hear from a couple community members talking about the benefits of these traffic calming that we've seen starting off in 2020. And now I'm going to hand it off to my colleague, Molly McKinley, who's going to talk about some of the policy recommendations that we're making in addition to encouraging the city to accelerate their implementation of these infrastructure improvements. Molly?
Thanks, Jill. I'm Molly McKinley. I work with Bicycle Colorado, but I'm the vice chair of the Denver Streets Partnership. You know, Jill covered a lot of the things that we're measuring the city on and the improvements that the city is committed to making. But we really think there's six policy changes that the city can make relatively quickly to make our streets safer. You know, we know a lot of these changes take a long time, but these are things that can be implemented relatively quickly. First, we encourage the city to lower speed limits throughout the city, changing the default speed limit from 25 miles an hour to 20 miles an hour. Speed is a really big factor when it comes to determining whether, you know, the severity of a crash. So we really encourage the city to lower that speed. Second one, we encourage the city to ban turns on red downtown and in the high injury network. We know a good number of crashes occur between drivers and bicyclists or pedestrians at intersections. And we also know a lot of close calls or near misses occur in those places. So banning those turns on red makes it clear for everyone about who's supposed to be going when and can help us avoid some of those near misses or crashes. Third, we encourage the city to increase fines for parking in or blocking bike lanes. When something is obstructing the bike lane, it can cause a bicyclist to have to merge into traffic, which just creates another possible conflict point for people biking and decreases the effectiveness of the infrastructure that we do install. Fourth, we encourage the city to eliminate pedestrian beg buttons, particularly on the high injury network. This gives folks the chance to have enough time to cross the street and more predictability about when they'll be able to do so. Fifth, there's some work that can be done at the state level to expand the use of photo enforcement and speed radar cameras throughout the city. We know that these things can reduce traffic injuries and fatalities and change people's behavior. And lastly, we need the city to fully fund these Vision Zero projects. It will take centuries at this point at the rate of the funding that we have to get these projects completed. And we just don't have that time. So we encourage the city to make that commitment and fund these projects. Next, I'll turn it over to Charlie Myers, who's gonna talk about his experience using the 35th Avenue bikeway. You know, this is something that we saw at the beginning of 2020, and it's something we hope to see more of throughout the city this year and in years to come.
Well, thank you, Molly and Jill. I'm a regular rider of the bikeway, so thanks for having me say a few words on it. I've been bicycling the 35th neighborhood bikeway for years now. So I know what it was like before all these wonderful changes. And it's a wonderful route. It's a very direct route coming from Wheat Ridge or even points west, even as far as Golden. Some riders take it, commute into the city via 35th. But prior to the improvements on the bikeway, this diverter was, of course, not there. It was a very harrowing experience to come up to Irving Street there, especially during rush hour. And you had cars going right, left, and straight. And the cyclist was in the mix of this kind of harrowing, very daunting experience. So I think the diverter is great because it separates, first of all, it stops or prevents drivers from going straight, and it only allows drivers to go make a right turn. So it simplifies the whole experience there. And really, I think we're looking at something that could be life-saving because I witnessed some harrowing experiences on coming up to that Irving Street intersection there. And so coming on down, the traffic circles, I think David's going to be speaking about that, but it makes for a very nice direct route into Denver. So thanks. That's what I have to add to it.
Thank you, Charlie. And next we're going to hear from community member David Chen. He's going to talk a little bit more about his experience using these new features on 35th Avenue that's part of the bikeway.
I think he has to be taken off mute.
Oh, sorry. I will go do that now.
No problem.
Okay, David, try. There we go.
Thanks, Joe. I live in Northwest Denver. I bike around the neighborhood with my kids, and so having this change has been pretty good for us. This is our route to the grocery store, to ballet class, to the library. So this is part of our regular, routine in terms of transportation. And these traffic circles, as imperfect as they are, and as much hue and cry as they've generated in the next door forums for the neighborhood, we enjoy them. We feel safer riding on West 35th because of the traffic circles. And what they do is they slow down traffic. They make the flow of traffic smoother in that it's no longer a stop sign. We don't have to do this stop and go action with which on a bike can kill your momentum and make for a less pleasant experience, certainly, and a less efficient experience. And also having a car sitting behind you at a stop sign trying to rev past you is quite a stressful experience. And so that entire sort of phenomenon is eliminated with this traffic circle. Now, drivers are imperfect, and so there's still a learning curve in how to use these, in that drivers will often make a left turn in them going the wrong way, or they'll be confused with the traffic circle. But I think the city has done a good job with this, running this as an experiment and themselves learning from the experience. So I hope that this gets extended to other bikeways across the city.
Great. So those are the main speakers that we had today. Again, to recap, the first part of what we were talking about was just grading the city's own Vision Zero plans. What did they lay out and where did they get to? Not just how many, but the locations. Are they putting them in the places where we're seeing the most injuries and the most crashes? That second part was just describing some of the additional policies we'd be recommending, from residential 20 mile per hour speed limits to some of the other, fully funding our Vision Zero network. And then third, we had a couple of community members talk about some specific things that have been implemented. Those two things were on 35th. And those are examples of things that we'd like to see in other parts as well. We've had a couple of questions come in. One quick question, which we can just answer, is did you verify the actions with the city? Did we verify the numbers? The answer is yes, we did there. And we did have a question, Jill, for you. How would you answer, are you concerned about not being able to see potential progress or decline in how Vision Zero is working next year in 2020 because the data from 2020 is going to be skewed by the stay-at-home order?
It is really interesting seeing how the traffic crashes have changed during COVID and the stay-at-home orders. You know, the Denver Police Department shared information recently about how traffic crashes overall are down by about 50% during this time. And traffic fatalities have almost disappeared. You know, last year we had about an average of 6 traffic fatalities per month. And during the now almost 2 months since the stay-at-home orders were initiated, we've only had 2 traffic fatalities. I think this is interesting information that tells us, you know, one of the big contributors to traffic fatalities is the number of cars on our street. And so to the extent that we can really encourage people to shift from driving to using other ways of getting around, like walking, biking, and transit, that is going to go a long way towards helping us achieve our Vision Zero goals. The other interesting that has happened during COVID is this city has been very nimble and responsive in repurposing some street space to provide safer and more space for people walking and biking, with the shared streets in residential and commercial areas where they've restricted through traffic, and what we call open streets in parks throughout the city where vehicle traffic isn't allowed at all. This is, you know, basically a great opportunity for the city to try out a different way of designing and prioritizing use of those streets. We've been doing some surveying and finding overwhelming community support for these streets and a desire to keep them in place more permanently after the pandemic, specifically because it makes them feel safer and they are more likely to walk and bike in their neighborhoods with these types of streets available to them.
Again, all the information we have is on our website, denverstreetspartnership.org. We had the link in the chat. We have the link in the chat box that gets you right to the report card and some of the graphics that you saw on the screen here. If you have a question, feel free to type it in the chat box. I think we also have the raise your hand feature as well. But in terms of the chat box, another question, this on the pace of change, Jill. So pace of change has been a big problem over the years. Has the city picked up its pace of implementation since our last report card, and in what ways have they done that?
So we did give the city a slightly better grade this year. Last year they got a C grade on progress in 2018. This year we're giving them a C plus grade overall in 2019. So we did see faster implementation in some areas. You know, I think street lighting is a great example of that. In the first year, they got a pretty poor grade because they did very little in terms of improving street lighting, whereas in 2019, they just ramped it up to a whole new level and implemented street lighting improvements throughout the entire city. So I think that's a good example of how they can act faster if they put their minds to it. And again, the changes that they have made during COVID, I think, is another great sign that the city can be nimble in responding to the safety needs of the community. And we did get 2020 off to a really great start with the traffic calming on 35th Avenue that our community members shared about, as well as traffic calming on East Colfax, where the city used paint and bollards to, you know, tighten up the travel lanes and reinforce slower speeds. So we're hopeful. We are heading in the right direction. It hasn't been fast enough, but we hope that we continue to see an acceleration going forward.
And what do you attribute that faster pace to, Jill? What would you say is kind of going on there?
I do think having the annual report card has been helpful in holding the city accountable and highlighting the areas where they have been doing well and not doing so well. As I mentioned, we did not give them a good grade for street lighting in 2018. And I think that helped shine a spotlight on the need to move faster in that area. And the city was responsive in that case.
Jill, can you speak to the idea that Denver is considering allowing restaurants to have some space? Some of that space might be into our streets and getting into that shared streets. Do you see that as potentially something that's going to help with our Vision Zero goals, or is it going to create additional problems by having more, you know, restaurant space maybe co-mingling with some of that street space?
If done well, I think this move to expand businesses into the public right-of-way can absolutely support our Vision Zero goals, and is really consistent with what we've heard from the community in terms of what they want. In our survey regarding the shared and open streets, one of the most common reasons people give for walking and biking is not only exercise, but also to access food and services in their neighborhood. And one of the biggest improvements they'd like to see to those shared and open streets is better connectivity to the destinations that they're trying to get to. And so there can be some great synergies in terms of creating safer corridors for people to walk and bike along and destinations that are welcoming to people walking and biking. Also, by repurposing some of the street space to serve not only people walking and biking, but the commerce and the activity that's happening in that area, again, we're shifting the priority away from cars and towards people and people safely interacting in that space. And so overall, that's going to improve safety by reducing our unhealthy dependence on cars and refocusing on the real priority, which should be people.
Yeah, I think I'd add in there as well, just from a street design standard perspective, oftentimes when you have streets that are really, really wide, that really kind of encourage the faster speeds that we see in vehicles, which are oftentimes the thing that increases the likelihood of fatalities or deaths. So having some of that space repurposed also just creates a narrower view for a driver, and is, you know, they're likely to drive slower, and that's going to be safer for everyone as well. Would you agree, Jill?
Absolutely. As Danny said, the width of the street is one of the biggest factors that contributes to speeding. And so narrowing the streets and reusing that space for, you know, to support the restaurants is a win-win in terms of supporting our local neighborhood business districts and reinforcing safe travel speeds.
One thing to emphasize as well, when we look at our report card, I think, you know, a couple of themes that did come out. One is they just didn't build as much of the sidewalks and bike lanes as they as was in their plan. But the second is location. In a lot of places, they were nimble and put in safety improvements, but they just weren't as much on the high injury network. Whereas Jill said, the high injury network is where it's 5% of our streets, but 50% of our fatalities.
Correct.
And not, you know, we really need to target our safety improvements, our Vision Zero improvements there. And that would go a long way to improving the score, the report card. We've got a question about just funding. So the city's facing a $260 million budget gap. How confident are we that Denver can fully fund the street safety projects? I guess there's kind of two questions here, maybe, Jill. One is just in their Vision Zero plan, do we anticipate the 2020 Vision Zero plan won't have enough funding because of this? And then just sort of broader, the graph we showed, Molly, you spoke to this, it's going to take 400 years at our current budget level to build out the whole infrastructure. So kind of two ways to look at the budget challenges.
Yeah, certainly. Some of the funding for Vision Zero does come from the bond funding that voters approved in 2017. And so we're hopeful and fairly confident that that funding will continue to be available. You know, a big chunk of that was dedicated for building out protected bike lanes and sidewalk facilities throughout the city. The city does face some serious challenges in looking at both its 2020 and its 2021 budget in how it cuts across the board in order to address these shortfalls. But we would argue that investing in safe streets is just as important now as ever, particularly as people start getting back to work. But we see that transit service cuts are going to be in place for a while. People need safe alternatives and options to get where they need to go. we've seen a huge boom in the number of people buying bikes during this time, showing a strong interest in using that as a way to get around. And they need the safe facilities to do so. The worst case scenario is we've got a bunch of new people out riding bikes, something that is consistent with our city's goals and we want people to do, but it's not safe because we haven't provided the infrastructure they need to get from their homes to their destinations.
I'm not seeing any other questions. We'll give it one more minute here. So again, if you have any questions, feel free to put it in the chat box here. And again, the information is at denverstreetspartnership.org, part of our Vision Zero page. The link is in our chat here. Jill, just put it back in there one more time. So questions for us about the report card and or for our two community members about just some of the safety infrastructure that they have experienced in the last year. Give you just another minute here if there are any other questions. Seeing none. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, David and Charlie, for joining us, and good luck riding out there. And thank you, Jill and Molly. Oh, wait, one more, Charlie. Oh, that's Charlie. Ed, Charlie, did you want to say something about the signage?
Well, we've been mentioning so much about the bicycle facilities, the diverter, the traffic circles and all that, how great they've been in terms of improving safety. But I also wanted to put in a plug for the signage, both the sharrows on the pavement itself, but also the wayfinding and destination finding. Jill, you were mentioning new cyclists getting out there. Often the wayfinding is very important for them to figure out the direction that they should be going in and all that. So just, Public Works has done a great job in handling all that fairly recently, too, just over the last few months. So I just wanted to mention that.
Sure. Absolutely. Great. All right. Well, thank you all for joining us. If you have any questions, feel free to follow up with any of us in the Denver Streets Partnership, Jill, Molly, or myself, and we will turn this off now. Thank you.